Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to today's sustainability seminar. My name is Nancy Holm. I'm the assistant director here at ISTC, and I help organize the seminars along with Beth Mischewski. We have the schedule for the spring seminars is on the table outside the conference room here, and for those listening online, we have these listed on our website. And in case you cannot attend in person, all of the seminars are shown live via GoToWebinar, and we also record them and archive them on our website. Sometimes it will take a few weeks before we get that posted, but you can check back on the website and we'll put those up. So to begin today, I'd like everyone in attendance to please silence your cell phones if you haven't done so already. And then I'll also ask that we're going to hold the questions to the end of the presentation, then I'll pass around the microphone so we can record those for our video recording. And those of you listening online, we have a number of people today online, you can type in your questions anytime, but then we'll answer those at the end also. So I'm very pleased today to introduce our speaker, Dr. Mike Lydy. Dr. Lydy is currently the professor in the Department of Zoology and a member of the Center for Fisheries, Aquaculture, and Aquatic Sciences at Southern Illinois University in Carbondale. He received his BA in chemistry from Wittenberg University, MS in zoology from Miami University, Ohio, and a PhD in zoology from Ohio State University. He spent 3 years with the U.S. Geological Survey in Indianapolis and 6 years at Wichita State University prior to his arrival at SIUC. His areas of interest for his research include evaluating the effects of chemical mixtures, developing a basic understanding of chemical and biological factors affecting toxicity, bioavailability and bioaccumulation, remediation of contaminated sites, and evaluating the effectiveness of best management practices in reducing pesticide and nutrient loading into aquatic systems. Dr. Lydy's authored a number of papers and book chapters, and he served as the focus editor for Environmental Toxicology and Chemistry and on the editorial boards for Environmental Pollution, Archives of Environmental Contamination and Toxicology, and Environmental Toxicology and Chemistry. So please join me in welcoming Dr. Lydy as our speaker today.
Thank you, Nancy, for that introduction. And I appreciate the invite to come up and talk to you guys about some of our science. What I'm presenting today is a series of studies we've done over the last almost 16 years now, looking at this concept of are terrestrial applied pesticides, and today's talk will be on pyrethroids, are they a threat to aquatic ecosystems, in particular the species that live in those systems? Before I get started, I want to acknowledge a number of folks. You can see that a lot of people are involved in the research in my lab over the years. A lot of students and postdocs. Yo Jing is now in China. She was a postdoc in my lab 5-6 years ago. Jennifer Heim is a grad student currently in my lab and that has done some of the work I'll be presenting in the latter part of this presentation. Kaylee Major is one of Helen Poynton's graduate students, PhD students, who worked with Dr. Susek here, and we're presenting some of Helen's and Kaylee's molecular work later in the talk. I also need to mention Don Weston. Don Weston and I actually sat down at a CTAC meeting in 2001 and came up with an idea to look at pyrethroids and effects on different organisms. And we wrote a small grant for, I think it was $30,000, that's expanded in the last 16 years to, I think we have 60 plus papers and over $7 million worth of grant funding. So small ideas can blossom into great things. The funding sources, we've had a number of agencies that have supported us. I want to point out the California State Water Resources Control Board. They were very monumental in getting us started with this pyrethroid work. Have funded us for a number of years. The National Science Foundation of China has funded Yu Jing and a lot of her work. We've gotten a number of star fellowships funded, the Department of Ag, and our current U.S. Geological Survey National Competitive Grants Program grant that's through U of I. And I'll talk a little bit about that and how it fits in the overall theme of these pyrethroid studies that we've been doing, but we're not to a point yet where I'm going to present data for that. But I'll at least give you a feel and a flavor of how that fits into things. So, a little bit about pyrethroids. Pyrethroids are synthetic esters derived from the natural chemical pyrethrins, which are from the chrysanthemum plant. They're nonpolar, and they have very high octanol water partition coefficients, which is a measure of their hydrophobicity. And therefore, they have a high affinity for organic matter in sediments and in organisms. They're a replacement of the federally restricted organophosphate insecticides like chlorpyrifos. And they're extremely toxic to aquatic species through, though they have very little mammalian toxicity, or they're not very toxic to birds. There are about 600 different products that have pyrethroids in them. The top four all have bifenthrin in them. The bathroid product has cifuthrin in it. The bear product has cifuthrin and the neonicotinoid and imidacloprid. A lot of times they'll put mixtures of these compounds in these formulations. Astro is permethrin, and Centra is lambda-cyhalothrin. So a lot of different products you would find at Walmart that you can use for your yard all have registered uses that have active ingredients that are pyrethroids. The general pyrethroids can be broken up into two different classes. The type 1 pyrethroids are things like bifenthrin, permethrin. And then type 2 pyrethroids include lambda-cyhalothrin, cifuthrin, cypermethrin, deltamethrin, and S-invalerate. There's about 1,000 different types of pyrethroids, but there's very few that are actually used in the U.S. And these are the seven probably most prominent pyrethroids for U.S. use. The difference between the two types, type 1 versus type 2, is basically this alpha-cyana group, right, on the type 2 pyrethroids, and they all contain that alpha-cyan functional group. The type 1 compounds, their mode of action is via T syndrome, while the type 2 is SC syndrome. And the difference between those two, I think, is the easiest to think about. If you have a wasp spray, if you spray the wasp, it immediately falls to the ground, right? That is the type 1. It has knockdown power, all right? The type 2 effect is one where they actually kill the wasp, okay? And so that's the difference between the two modes of action of the pyrethroids. So pyrethroids are neurotoxins, and so they're going to go ahead and affect the normal action potential that goes along a nerve, right? So we're going to go, the action potential is going to go this way, and the sodium channels are responsible for the initiation and the propagation of that action potential by allowing sodium to influx into the cell. Pyrethroids prolong that opening of the sodium channel, resulting in repetitive firing and membrane depolarization. And the type 1 pyrethroids do that for milliseconds. Type 2 do it for minutes. And so the difference between the knockdown power versus the killing power of the insecticides. Okay, so one of the first questions we asked, and it was a very important one, was how prevalent are pyrethroids in the environment? Are they detected at high enough concentration to cause effects to a variety of non-target species? And our target species is Hyalella azteca, all right? And it's an amphipod that is ubiquitous throughout the United States. It is a complex of different species, actually, but it works well for toxicity testing. It resides at the, it's an epibenthic invertebrate, so it sits at the sediment-water interface, and it's used in standard EPA testing for bioaccumulation and toxicity. So this first study, I'm really going to concentrate on the Central Valley of California. And we looked at water bodies that were next to orchards, row crop agriculture, and then urban and suburban sites throughout the Central Valley. We took 189 total samples. 106 were from agricultural sites, and 83 were from urban-dominated water bodies. We collected sediment and did toxicity tests and measured the concentration that was extractable via exhaustive chemical extraction. Conducted 10-day toxicity tests, again with Hyalella azteca, and a total of 31 pesticides were determined using GC-ECD, and we actually used GC mass spec also, reporting limit was about one part per billion. pyrethroids that we looked at were the class list that I gave you earlier. We looked at one organophosphate, which was chlorpyrifos, and a series of organochlorine insecticides, including DDT and its metabolites. So more of the legacy organochlorines that are found in California. So this first slide I'm going to show you is basically looking at the number of mixture components in either ag or urban sites. So we're going to break the landscapes up or land uses up. And so in this case, I've got the frequency of detection and then the number of components in that mixture. So for agricultural sites, we have some sites, you know, 10% that basically had none of the target analytes. About 40% had one of the target analytes, and we didn't really see very many complex mixtures and we look at ag. If we look at urban sites, we see a totally different picture. We had no sites that had no detects, which was impressive, and about 60% of the sites had at least six components in that mixture, okay? Which is quite impressive. So quite different in terms of the composition of insecticides at these sites. If we look at the frequency of compound detection, so I'm looking at specific compounds now, I'm looking at ag sites, frequency in an individual compounds, you can see permethrin had about 50-60% detection rate or frequency of detection, followed by esfenvalerate, chlorpyrifos, bifenthrin, and lambda, which were all around 20%, 30%. So they were predominantly pyrethroids in the top five for the ag sites. But again, the highest one would be permethrin, about 45-50%. Again, we get a totally different signature in the urban environment. We now have bifenthrin is the leading compound, but it's very similar to permethrin. But look at the frequency of detection. 90% of the sediments had detectable concentrations of these two pyrethroids. And if we look at the list here, we don't see chlorpyrifos. It's all the way down here. So the top five are all pyrethroids. Okay? So again, different signatures based on if you're in an urban or ag site. So the players in terms of dominant compounds in terms of detection, permethrin in the ag sites, followed by esfenvalerate, again, much higher levels here in the urban locations. Look at the number of pyrethroids are at least 60%. All right, that's the extractable, chemical extractable concentrations. Now I want to relate that to a toxicological endpoint. So I'm going to look at sediment 10-day toxicity tests. So these are tests that I'm doing in the laboratory to get the LC50, the lethal concentration that will kill 50% of my Hyalella. And so we ran a series of toxicity tests, and we found that if you look at the LC50s in terms of micrograms per gram, organic carbons, we often normalize for organic carbon. As I told you earlier, these bind to organic carbon because they're very hydrophobic. The most toxic of these is, and this is really toxic, is 0.45 was lambda cyhalothrin, micrograms per gram OC. Bifenthrin is similar. The least toxic of our pyrethroids is permethrin. We did the same thing for the organochlorines and chlorpyrifos. So how do I know that a sediment that contains pyrethroids actually is going to be toxic to my species? And so we use a toxicity or toxic unit approach where I take the actual concentration of the sediment, which I measured with a chemical, exhaustive chemical extraction technique, and I divide that by the high-low LC50 I've determined in the laboratory. These TUs are all calculated in organic carbon normalized basis. We assume additivity of the pesticides, which is reasonable because they're all nerve toxins. We've done a number of studies going across organochlorines to pyrethroids and within pyrethroid comparisons and found that they were additive. And I set the benchmark at a half of a TU. Again, a TU would be a toxic unit concentration where the actual concentration equals the LC50. Well, we don't want our high-low to be all dead. And therefore, we're going to set a benchmark a little lower than that. And then I'm going to calculate values for all these sites and see how many of these exceed this 0.5 toxic unit benchmark. So now what I'm looking at is the frequency of detections of exceedance of that 0.5 TU benchmark for ag sites. So 12% of the sites had enough bifenthrin to kill my Hyalella, and around 8% for lambda cyhalothrin and so forth. Okay. If we you look at the urban site, something should pop at you, right? The thing that is interesting about this one, 78% of the sites had enough bifenthrin to kill my Hyalella at least a benchmark level of 0.5 TU, all right? And notice the last slide also had bifenthrin as the predominant player in terms of toxicity. We also have cifuthrin around 20%, delta, and then the other pyrethroids kind of drop off, right? So if you look at the dominant pesticides in terms of risk, now we have bifenthrin at 12%, bifenthrin in urban sites at 78%, and a number of other players. And the thing that you should notice, chlorpyrifos is here, but they're at 1 and 2%. OPs are not going to be an issue. It's a pyrethroid and predominantly a bifenthrin issue. So in summary, from this first study, we saw complex mixtures of pesticides occur in urban sediments, like 6, 7, 8 components, while we found very simple mixtures in agricultural sites. We found that very interesting. We actually had a series of studies where we could actually, we looked at the signatures. You gave me, one of my collaborators gave me sediments, and we could tell them if it was from an ag and urban site based on the pyrethroid signature, right? Pyrethroid insecticides are the dominant concern, obviously, in terms of frequency of detections and relative toxicity, and bifenthrin being the one that's the most problematic, all right? And again, the pyrethroid concentrations were sufficiently high enough to explain most of the observed toxicity based on the toxic unit approach. I've mentioned bifenthrin's importance, and then obviously there are other pyrethroids that are important depending on if it's an ag or urban site that will direct which pyrethroids you find. So I go back to the original question, how prevalent are pyrethroids in the environment and are they detected at high enough concentrations to be a concern? The answer is very much so and yes, okay? But you might be asking, all right, if you collect a sediment from an urban site, there's just not pyrethroids in there. There's going to be PCBs and PAHs and a variety of other things, right? It's a soup of stuff, right? So how do we determine if it's due to pyrethroids? And so the quantification, again, presence does not always equal toxicity. So we use things called toxicity evaluation or identification evaluations, or TIEs. And so basically the concept was to take our toxic unit and put that in terms of a TIE approach, right? Got something out of whack here. Hold on a sec. There's the TIE. All right, we'll come back. We'll keep going. So if you look at the toxic unit response, like I said, it's the environmental concentration on OC basis divided by the 10-day Hyalella LC50 value. And if toxicity was going to be due to pyrethroids, we'd expect a curve that I've got the sum of toxic units of TU down here of pyrethroids, and I've got the Hyalella mortality here. What we'd normally expect is a normal S-shaped curve where one toxic unit would be 50% of my Hyalella dying, right? And so we took the data from the previous studies, and you can see it fits pretty well. This is the pyrethroid distribution and sediment toxicity from 5 or 6 different papers. You can see there are some data that does not fit the S-shaped curve. I've got the values over here, which are going to be other contaminants. So the amount of pyrethroids here is not very high, but we're seeing more mortality than we would expect. What was interesting in this was a lot of times, especially in California, it was due to fipronil, which is also another pesticide supposedly going to take the place maybe of pyrethroids if they get to a point where they're going to be restricted and is used in a variety of applications out there. The other part is if I have a lot of pyrethroids that I can measure in a very exhaustive chemical extraction, but I'm not seeing a lot of mortality, it's because it's a bioavailability issue. The compounds are bound, they're not coming off and are available. And our USGS project with you guys is basically worrying about this concept. And I'll talk a little bit more about that later in the talk. So let's get back to the TIE. TIE, in theory, you should be able to take a sediment that's toxic. You go in and amend it. You amend it with zeolite. Zeolite removes ammonia, all right? If the sediment then, after you've added the zeolite, is no longer toxic, then you know it's ammonia that is the problem. If you go in, if it does not get rid of the toxicity, you go back up and you test the system again. You can add things like a chelating agent, some type of resin to get rid of metals. You can go ahead and put activated carbon into the system, and that will remove the organics. And again, you're going to go ahead and test it with your animals again, and therefore you don't have to look for everything all at once. It's a way of knocking down and removing potential issues. Well, that wasn't good enough for us for pyrethroids, because getting it to an organic, there's so many organic compounds there that I don't want to worry about that. So I want to make it a little bit easier for us. And so Don and Weston and I developed a series of what are called compound-specific TIEs for pyrethroids. Right? And we used three different approaches. We looked at esterases, propanol butoxide, or PBO, and then a variety of different temperature manipulations. So, pyrethroids have an ester bond, which can be broken down by carboxyl esterases. And so we have some that are very specific for pyrethroids. And if you go in and add a carboxyl esterase to a sediment, and you no longer see the toxicity, because the metabolites are not toxic, they have other problems with them, but they're not toxic, therefore you would see a reduction in toxicity if it's due to pyrethroids. Another approach is to actually look at the P450 system. So pyrethroids get in the body of the Hyalella, the P450 system is induced, it should break down the compound, right? The interesting component is if we add propanol butoxide, it affects the P450 system by decreasing biotransformation. It blocks a lot of those pathways. And so by blocking the pathway, we decrease the biotransformation and increase the toxicity, and it's usually two or three fold. So it's very obvious that if we put PBO in the system, it cranks up the system. So we can use these in combination, but I like the third one probably best. So again, we block it. Third one is temperature. Pyrethroids are very unique in the context that they're inversely related, their toxicity is inversely related to temperature. So if you decrease temperature, we decrease biotransformation, and we actually increase the toxicity of the pyrethroids. So the combination of these three different tests, focused TIEs, allows us to identify and say pretty confidently that if we have toxicity in the sediment, our TUs focused TIEs. California's got lots of problems. I'm sorry. So you have, is it a pyrethroid problem just in California because of the amount of ag that's out there? And I keep going. But the answer to that is, no, I don't. I'm stuck. And the answer is no. So I did a study with one of my grad students. I don't do any of the work, by the way. All this stuff is done by graduate students and all the important people. I just come and have the glory to talk about it, okay? We did a study, obviously, throughout all of Illinois. We didn't go up to Chicago. We actually were in this area. We were in Springfield and a variety of other locations and looked at both ag and urban sites, and we saw exactly the same thing we saw in California, where bifenthrin was a predominant problem, especially in urban sites. We did a study with a former graduate student of mine, Jason Belden, and some of his students, urban areas in Texas, same story. In the U.S. Geological Survey, after we started collecting data on pyrethroids, decided, hey, this looks interesting. Let's go ahead and do a survey of urban areas throughout the United States. And Kathy Kuvla and Bob Gilliam and those guys found the same thing we found, bifenthrin, predominantly a problem, urban sites. We expanded to other countries. We went to, again, Yo Jing is at the Academy of Science in Guangzhou, and she did a study on the Pearl River Delta. And talk about systems that have a lot of stuff in them. The pollution in China is really, I spent 2 weeks there. It's very discouraging, okay? But it's interesting, even with all that pollution, pyrethroids came out as a predominant issue, and it switched from bifenthrin to cypermethrin. Is switched, and the reason why is because cypermethrin is much less expensive. We've also had a study, and I'm going to show to you, that just came out where we have the same issues in South America. And so again, it's a cypermethrin issue because of cost. And so, you know, the question is, it's obviously a worldwide issue. let's take it one step further. Where are the pyrethroids coming from specifically? All right, and specifically, let's look at bifenthrin. And I'm going to cut to the chase because I'm running out of time. We looked at a whole variety of different landscape applications, flea and pet collars and all that kind of good stuff. And what it came down to is the most important ones were actually at Walmart and some of your retail stores, where we have granular products you can pull off the shelf and use for fertilizer and pesticide control on your yards. Look where most of those are main ingredient, bifenthrin. You have some lambda cyhalothrin. There is some liquid concentrates that are different, but majority of them are bifenthrin based, and I'd say the majority of them also are pyrethroid based. So we decided to do some back of the envelope calculations to figure out, all right, can this be a problem? And so let's assume that we're just taking ortho bug begon max insect killer for yards, and there are a lot of other products that could be used in a similar manner. We assume an application to the lawn using a spreader at the recommended rate and a modest lawn size. This is a California yard, okay? It's not one you'd find here or in the Midwest. 30 by 30 is a pretty small yard, right? And assume a loss of 1% of the applied amount, which is about 8 milligrams of bifenthrin. That's very reasonable because you're...
The broadcast is now starting. All attendees are in listen-only mode.
And wash it off on your driveway. That's an impervious surface. It's going to run down to the storm drain and go out to the creek. So 1% might even be a low estimate. So the question that we posed ourselves was, how much would that 8 milligrams of bifenthrin have to be diluted before it was no longer acutely toxic to Hyalella? So process that, okay, got a number. If diluted in sediment, it would require 3 tons of sediment with a wet weight assumption, and assuming 2% organic carbon and 60% solid content. Or if you put that same amount into an Olympic-sized swimming pool, which is about 1 million gallons, that would dilute it to a point where you would actually no longer kill your Hyalella. You get the point? So the source, we believe, is obviously there's lots of sources of pyrethroids, but the main source, I think, is suburbia. And the use of bifenthrin and a lot of these pyrethroids in a way that they're not intended to be used. For example, if you apply fertilizer 2 or 3 times throughout the year, you're getting a bifenthrin dose each time. Bifenthrin is added in a lot of these products. I would challenge you to go to the store and find something that doesn't have an insecticide associated with it. So if you're putting it on 3 or 4 times a year, it's going to accumulate. The half-life of bifenthrin in our studies is a year. You don't need to apply it 4 times a year. You don't need to apply it more than once a year. And so I think the education process of educating the public that they need to really look at the packages and apply things in a responsible manner is important. We'll switch gears. I've now shown you that pyrethroids are, at least in my mind, a concern to aquatic systems. But we found some really interesting stuff. When we started looking at sites in California, we measured concentrations in the sediment, and they had lots of pyrethroids in them. Okay. But then when we were collecting the sediments, we went, oh, there's Hyalella here. That's weird, because this Hyalella should all be dead. And so we started doing a series of studies, toxicological studies, where we took sediments from a variety of different sources, or animals from a variety of different sources, and then dose them. And as you can see here, we've got a lab culture, and these are different species, and Dr. Susek is an expert at this, right? Provisional species, different clades, depends on how you want to phrase it. So they're different provisional species, okay, keep that in mind. But I've got a population out of UC Berkeley where Don Weston works, and he tested these with cyfruthrin in a 96-hour LC50 experiment. He got about 4.8 nanograms per liter. Looked at Laguna Lake and Blodgett Reservoir. Both of those, we did not detect any pyrethroids in the sediments. Nothing in the water. They were clean sites. Okay? And if you look at their LC50s, they're very similar to the lab culture. If you look at Pleasant Grove Creek and these guys down in the C group, they all had pyrethroids in the sediments. There was a little bit in Pleasant Grove. There were a lot of pyrethroids in the sediments down here. And you can see the relative tolerance goes up quite a bit. So it takes a lot more of these compounds, or the cyfrutherin, to kill the Hyalella than it did the lab population or the sites where there are no pyrethroids. So if you have pyrethroids in the sediment, those animals now are very resistant to pyrethroid exposure. So what we then did is we talked to Helen Poyton at University of Massachusetts Boston and Kaylee Major, and we asked them to look at the resistance of these Hyalella populations, and they did the genetics behind that. I won't go to the details of that, but what they found was basically these Hyalella populations that achieved resistance had mutations at the voltage-gated sodium channel found on chromosome 3, and the resistant Hyalella populations contained one of these two mutations. The one at the 918 mutation, which is called the super KDR, super knockdown resistance, and it's very well known in insects. And we also, she also found the 925 mutation, which is the Hyalella have both of these. Most of the populations, I think the majority of them are this 925 mutation. So the mutation due to being in the soup of pyrethroids at a site that now allows them to have resistance. This was news, or big news, because most of the resistances found are on actual vector species like mosquitoes, and pyrethroids are not intentionally applied to aquatic systems, applied to terrestrial systems and then run off into an aquatic system and now have caused resistance, right? So again, pretty big news. So, but there's a little bit of a controversy. We came out with our PNAS paper saying, hey, we've got this mutation. And then Clark et al. Came out and actually collected field, collected Hyalella at the same sites we collected them at. And by the way, Clark et al. Is a consultant and works with the Pyrethroid Working Group. They found values in their Hyalella that they collected from the field that were 49 to 300 times greater than cypermethrin and bifenthrin in field-collected Hyalella. So they're very similar responses to what we found. But then they held their animals in for a very short period of time, a couple months, and they lost their tolerance. Tolerance was gone, but it wasn't all gone, it was partly gone, right? And they attributed it to non-genetic enzyme activity, but they didn't measure the voltage-gated sodium channel mutations like we did. And so, all right, said, all right, we want to address this question. Is it an adaptation or acclimation? So if it's an acclimation, it'd just be something, I've got induced numbers of enzymes, it's going to break down the compound, okay, versus an actual adaptation or mutation. So we addressed that question by looking at the, is resistance maintained in these animals if they're cultured long-term in a pyrethroid-free environment? There's no reason to force them to be resistant. So we chose two populations, one from Mosher Slough, which is in Stockton. This is a declade resistant population that has been cultured in my lab since 2013. And we had our C-clade non-resistant that's been cultured since I arrived at SIU in 2001, and that's the standard US EPA lab group. I should make note that the comparison they're making are going to be within clade, so I'm not comparing D versus C here. I'm comparing D to D and C to C. So we ran a series of toxicity tests. We had the resistant Hyalella tested at 14, 22, and 30 months after being in culture. Non-resistant Hyalella were also tested, but I test them routinely a couple times a year as a qualifier just to make sure my cultures are doing well. So I'm just going to report a few of these values. We use standard EPA protocols for the toxicity test, which includes a 96-hour static water-only exposure to permethrin. Lethality is the endpoint. We use probate analysis to determine the LC50s, and we place 10 of these Hyalella. That's not by size. If you've never seen a Hyalella, they're very, very small. 10 of them in a beaker, and we place screen in there to act as a habitat for them because they are usually off the sediment-water interface. They're unhappy if they're in a beaker by themselves. So here are some of those results. And so I have the non-resistant data here in the first two blocks, the test dates. And again, I'm only including a couple of the non-resistant times, but you can see they're very consistent. The LC50s were 34 nanograms per liter and 31. We're always around 30 for our lab population. But then we look at our resistant populations. July of 2015, 14 months in culture, it was 1,100. resistant population was tested again in February of 16, 22 months of culture, 1600. Resistant population, 30 months, 14, 18. All their confidence intervals overlap, so they are all, those are not significantly different, but you can see their resistance still. So again, approximately 53-fold decreased sensitivity to permethrin, and it's retained over time. So the question comes down to, was this a result of the mutation being maintained in that population? The answer is yes. Haley and their group went ahead and measured those in the mutation. We've got data that's more recent than this in 16 months. It's the mutations, particularly at the 925 location, that's being maintained. Okay? So, is it an adaptation or acclimation? The monstrous slew, Hyalella, appear to be permanently genetically altered, again, at that 925 location, so it's an adaptation. The monstrous slew, Hyalella, maintained pyrethroid resistance when cultured in a pyrethroid-free environment, 50 times the non-resistant animals. It's an adaptation. We have collected animals, however, recently collected from the field to kind of address this question. Maybe there's acclimation that's occurring really early on, and then they lose that after a generation. And we did those tests, and that is correct. When we ran the LC50s for a monstrous slew population that was freshly collected, it was twice the 1400 measure I just showed you. And so there is a component that is acclimation, so the PWG group were correct in that assumption, but they were incorrect in assuming that that is going to bring them back down to non-resistant levels. So there's an acclimation is involved, but it's not a heritable trait. So you're thinking, all right, these things are resistant to pyrethroids. Maybe we have an impact on bioaccumulation, because if you're resistant to it, maybe we can bioaccumulate more. Well, that could be a problem, right? And so we looked at bioaccumulation in Hyalella, and then we went one more step and said, let's look at the predatory species and see if it can be magnified up the food chain, because the fish are really sensitive to pyrethroids. So we did an experiment, and we used radio-labeled permethrin this time, because it's easier to track things at low levels, and especially when, since we were looking at biotransformation products, we went to a radio-labeled version. We exposed Hyalella that were 7 to 14 days old until they reached steady state levels. We euthanized the Hyalella, then homogenized the tissues and put it on a liquid scintillation counter to determine the amount of radioactivity. And this is C-labeled, so you're not going to lose it easily. Okay? We also took a subset of those and the homogenate and ran it on HPLC to separate the size fractions and be able to separate the permethrin and biotransformation products, so I know how much is transformed at that point. Okay? So here's some of that data. This is a figure where I've got tissue concentration in micrograms per gram wet weight on the y-axis. The x-axis has got concentrations, water concentrations with 24, 46, 86, and these higher concentrations in nanograms per liter. The NR is non-resistant, the RES is resistant. You see from the figure, I've got 72 hours and 24. These exposures were different, but we chose different exposure route numbers because we did a series of toxicokinetic studies to show that the resistant animals actually achieved steady state in a much shorter period of time at 24 hours, while the non-resistant took longer. So these tests where we were comparing both and included the non-resistant needed to go a little longer exposure. But they're both at steady state, so they're equivalent. Okay? And so the things you see is basically there's similar bioaccumulation between non-resistant and resistant animals. And remember, the LC50 for the non-resistant animals is about here at 30. And so we're at 86. We're actually, they're sick at that point. They're not very happy. And so we get a little bit larger error bar here. But there's still no significant differences between resistant and non-resistant. Okay. But because my non-resistants are dead here, these concentrations, you can see that the resistant animals will increase the amount of bioaccumulation that occurs just because they're resistant. Some pretty significant increases. If you look at the transformation products, this is a similar slide, but we're now looking at biotransformation products are now in gray and the parent compounds in X, or in black, I'm sorry. You can see, again, no differences here, but you can see the percentages or amount parent that, you know, 80%, 90% of the compound has been biotransformed. Okay. And then in the resistant animals, it's less, but it's probably because we have a shorter exposure period. If I give them out longer exposure, in theory, since these are at steady state, they come across, but you get more metabolites. Okay. So we get a significant amount of more bioaccumulation in the resistant population because they can tolerate it. So next question was, what is the potential for permethrin trophic transfer from Hyalella to fatheads? And so I exposed 15 Hyalella in a C14 labeled bath, water bath, at 780 nanograms per liter, which was the higher end of the concentrations I just showed you. Exposed the animals for 24 hours, then fed 15 Hyalella per day to fathead minnows. And 15 is not what they would eat if they were fully fed. I should point that out. They probably would eat 35 to 50 a day, all right? But we didn't have enough radioactivity to do that. So we wanted to see, this is kind of a worst case scenario, will this work? The fatheads were fed for 4 days. Again, we don't know if that was steady state. It probably wasn't steady state. And we used a static renewal system, so we kept changing out the water so that the fatheads would not re-uptake the material that they eliminated. Here are those results. On the y-axis, I've got tissue concentrations of micrograms per gram lipid. I've got the fatheads here, resistant Hyalella here. Note that the resistant Hyalella, this value is very similar to the last figure that I showed you when we tested the resistant Hyalella by themselves. And it's a little bit confusing because the parent compound looks like it's much larger here. It's not because of the break here. It was the same amount. Again, 47% was parent compound. What was interesting is if we fed fathead minnows non-resistant Hyalella exposed at the highest concentration we can measure, we don't get detectable levels in fatheads. But when we expose resistant Hyalella, now we have detectable levels in fatheads. It's much lower here, but it's still detectable levels, right? That's important. That's important because fatheads, again, are very sensitive to pyrethroids. So kind of the findings, we found detectable concentrations of, again, permethrin and its biotransformation products. Transfer could be parent compounds from the Hyalella to the fatheads. It could be even metabolites that are being transferred. We don't know yet. These body residues are most likely underestimating bioaccumulation potential at steady state, both in the, or at least in the fathead minnows, because we're not feeding to cessation, and we're not at steady state, most likely. So the exposure expected to be even greater for sensitive species that are not able to tolerate pyrethroid exposures at a site, ones that don't biotransform the compound as well, and for fish or birds that heavily rely on Hyalella as an important food source. And there are a lot of fish species and some bird species that Hyalella is like 80 to 90% of their food. Okay? Okay. Switch gears again. So the next few are going to be kind of rapid fire, different types of questions that we're asking that go back to the original question, are pyrethroids an issue to non-target aquatic species? So in this case, we are really interested in understanding this mutated population, and are there costs due to having this mutation? So we challenge them, and this is Jennifer Heim's work, with a series of toxicity tests, sodium chloride. Hyalella can handle a wide range of salinities. They can be used in marine systems. They're found in freshwater. They're really adaptable to sodium chloride levels. We tested DDT, copper sulfate, looked at their upper thermal tolerance. We did reproductive tests. We did a whole bunch of different things. I'm going to limit my discussion here to just a few of those, okay, and that kind of gives you the flavor of this. So the top one is sodium chloride. So we've got sodium chloride. Sodium chloride concentrations in milligrams per liter. And I've got the blue ones are the resistant populations, and the red ones are the non-resistant populations. And for Dave, we made sure that we included within clade and outside of clade comparisons because of your work. And so we have here the non-resistant clade C, that's our normal lab population, and we did that test a couple times, several months apart. We had a field non-resistant population of D clade, and then we had the SIU resistant D clades that were from the field that were collected 2 years ago, and then we had a field resistant clade, field resistant population that were freshly collected, all from the same site. So So these are all from Mosher slough, right? And as you can see, their ability, the resistant population's ability to handle sodium chloride challenges was less, significantly less. I want to talk just a second about this site. This site is cool. This site's in the middle of Mojave Desert. So Don Weston went across the entire state of California, and we're going, my God, there's pyrethroids everywhere. Let's go to the middle of the desert, okay? So we went in the middle of the desert. This is the coolest, and there's Don. See, Don's the one that's working, right? This strip of water is the only water in the Mojave Desert, and it's only about 100 meters long. It's generated because there's water that's percolating up to the surface, but it doesn't hit the surface anywhere except for this little trough. The trough is there because ATV vehicles go through the desert, come through here, and it's dug out that space, and now there's water sitting in it. What's cool about that are there are Hyalella living in this that have not been exposed to anything else. The duck came in and deposited some Hyalella. I don't know. They have some flying Hyalella in California. But they're there. And so this population is quite unique in that context. Sorry to deviate back to that. That's just too cool of a site. So you drive like 8 miles through the desert to get to this water body, and it's just this little hole where these resistant or non-resistant Hyalella live. So that is, again, this population here. So again, resistant, less sensitive to chloride. We also looked at temperature. So obviously, global warming is an issue. I've got, this is my non-resistant clade C and the SIU-resistant clade D. So this is the group that have been sitting in the lab for a long period of time that are resistant. This is our normal lab population, and there was a significant decrease in their ability to handle a thermal stress. This is putting them in a container and warming them up over time, and they lose their is an immobilization endpoint. In this one, we looked at both declade animals, a field non-resistant and a field resistant. You can see similar response. So it's not a clade-based issue. It is a resistance versus non-resistance issue. Okay. So there are costs, and costs are a relative term here. What are the costs of this resistance? We have increased bioaccumulation potential in the Hyalella themselves. We have increased chance of biomagnification up the food chain. We have a decreased tolerance to other stressors, and we have implications to bioassessments, because if I am a state employee and I go out to a stream and I'm monitoring the macroinvertebrate communities, I'm looking for sensitive species, and I go, oh, there's a Hyalella here. Well, there's lots of Hyalella here. This is a clean site, because Hyalella are an indicator of pollution. If there's a lot of pollution, you don't find Hyalella. And I sure as heck wouldn't expect to find Hyalella if there's pyrethroids at the site, because they kill them too at very low concentrations. And so this can make major implications to bioassessments and how a survey is done in terms of defining a site being clean or not. So, switch gears again. One of the things that we were interested in, and this is from an undergraduate project. We always promote undergraduate research, right? This, at our institution, they're really promoting that. So I have an undergrad who's a junior that's doing this experiment. So she spends many, many hours breeding resistant versus non-resistant Hyalella. So in this case, what we were interested in is knowing, is resistance a dominant or recessive trait? And so we took resistant Hyalella and bred them with non-resistant. And she needed it. She told me to put the heart in there, so I have the heart. And so what we're going to produce is resistant animals. We can produce non-resistant animals, and we can produce heterozygotes, or ones that have mixed characteristics. And so we ran that test, and up top is my populations, the non-resistant and resistant populations. This is the data you saw earlier, right? Non-resistant 30, 1,400 for the resistant. But if we looked at the combinations, and again, we did it with different clades and with similar clades, they come out exactly the same, and they've lost their resistance, right? They've gone back to the wild-type population. And so the question is, does the genetics agree with that? And the answer is, Kaylee just ran those in the last month, and they have the mutation is recessive, which is quite interesting. So, question you might ask yourself is, all right, he's saying all this negative stuff. What can we do to make this better? So things you can do if it's an urban location are don't apply the pesticide or the granular form or anything on impervious surfaces, because it ultimately just goes down here into the storm drain. Don't clean off your spreader on your driveway, all right? That's not a good thing. Get rid of your packages. I always find this one kind of fun. Star Wars lawn fertilizer, the force be strong with these plants. I don't know why I leave that up there, but I think it's funny. In agricultural sites, what can the farmers do? Obviously, BMPs, best management practices, can put in buffer zones between your row crop agriculture to reduce the loading into these aquatic water bodies. And Don and I have done a number of studies in California where we used polyacrylamide to basically, which is a non-toxic soil stabilizer, to basically keep the soil on site. Because again, these pyrethroids are hydrophobic, they get on the particulates that come off site. And this allows us to prevent that from happening. This is a normal system without the PAM, this is one with PAM. So you can see a definite difference in the amount of soil that's staying on site and pyrethroids. So kind of take home messages from the stuff I've talked about at this point. Pyrethroids are prevalent in aquatic systems and are present at high enough concentrations to severely impact sensitive and non-target species. The elevated concentrations have been found in sediments in multiple countries. It appears to be largely an urban homeowner problem. Therefore, education programs that are targeted towards the urban homeowner would be very beneficial. The resistance is developed in Hyalella and is widespread throughout California. We have a paper that's coming out, Kaylee's work, that will show it's again, very prevalent. I won't get into the details. Adaptation has occurred in Hyalella due to exposure to these terrestrially applied pyrethroids. Non-resistant Hyalella cannot survive at high permethrin concentrations or pyrethroid exposures. Thus, pyrethroid resistance increases the relative risk of permethrin and trophic transfer. Pyrethroid-resistant Hyalella increased fish exposure to permethrin and its biotransformation products, and therefore it's adding an additional unexpected exposure route. It's not one that people think about because they think, all right, pyrethroids in sediment, they're not going to get in the water. If they don't get in the water or if they don't get into the food, then it's not going to be taken up by the predator species. But we've now shown that that is true. It's providing this additional route. And then the increased risk of altered sex ratios and feminization of male fish could happen, which could result in population decline as the estrogenic biotransformation products start to accumulate, either as direct uptake from the Hyalella or by biotransformation in the fish itself. All right, that's that. I wanted to take just a few minutes to talk about our USGS project and how that fits in. We were awarded a USGS project that goes through U of I, and it basically is looking at this concept of bioavailability of pyrethroids in urban sites in the East Coast. NACWA has one of their synoptic studies, which is looking at, I think their total number of sites is like 70 or 80. We've targeted the 50 urban sites for them to collect sediments. They send them to us. We do a series of tests on them. We also split the samples and send them to Columbia Lab of USGS, and they do additional toxicity tests. So, little background, bioavailability. Which of these two sediments is going to be more toxic to some, like an amphipod? Would you predict this one? If you assume, I should point out, these are pyrethroids. The little dots are pyrethroids. Sorry. That makes it a little easier. The left one's more toxic. Of course it is. Look at all those pyrethroids, right? But, and I should point out, these are sediments. Interstitial water is the water between the sediment particles, but for simplicity purposes, I put it above. So it's kind of overlying water in this context. So by the magic of PowerPoint, we want to look at what's bioavailable. What's bioavailable is actually the same. And so your response in your animals is going to be the same. So bioaccumulation is the same. Toxicity should be the same. So it's a bioavailability issue. And if you noticed in the earlier slide, earlier in the talk, I showed you the bioavailability was a cause for sites where you have high pyrethroids, but it's not toxic. Why is it not toxic? Because the sediment information, the exhaustive chemical extraction says there's a lot of pyrethroids there. But when you actually look at the sediments and what's in the overlying water, it's the same. So there are a variety of techniques you can use to get at bioavailability. We've used passive samplers. I don't like passive samplers very much. I like desorption-based samplers. And this is Tenix. Tenix is a polymer resin that you can put in. It's used for pigeon trap units for years and years. But some very smart people back in the 90s, not me, decided, oh, this stuff will pull things off and you can measure desorption rates of compounds out of a sediment. That's really interesting. It's really easy. What you do is you have a test tube, you put the Tenix in, which floats, and then you spin, put your sediment in here, and you spin it. And what it does is it has contact with the sediment, and after 24 hours or so, you pull it out and you can figure out what is desorbed into the freely dissolved phase of the sediment. So again, some terminology here. I've got the pyrethroids that have gone down and bound to organic matter. So you can think of this as organic matter, organic matter, organic matter. And this is the rapidly desorbing fraction. This is a slow desorbing fraction. This is very slow. So the rapidly desorbing fraction would be on the surface. So it easily desorbs and it goes back and forth with the pore water. The slow is going to be down in the nooks and crannies a little bit, be attached a little bit more tightly. And then the slow is down in the middle of the molecule, the organic carbon molecule, and it doesn't come out very fast. It has a rate, but it's very slow. And so those things will desorb into the interstitial water, and then we've got biota there. There's your Hyalella. And then the Hyalella will pick that compound up by taking it up from the interstitial water. The tenex will also measure that rate, so there's a direct relationship between the biota and the tenex. What we have data-wise to prove that point is the following. I've got, this is an accumulation of about 7 studies, and what we're plotting here is the log of the concentration of the animal in nanograms per gram lipid and the 10x 24-hour concentration in nanograms per gram organic carbon. And the yellow are PCBs, we've got some PAHs, we've got pyrethroids, we've got a variety of different compound classes. R squared is 0.92. That's pretty darn good for sediments that are taken out of different locations. These include sediments that were brought back to the lab, and then we expose oligochaetes and Hyalella and other things in the laboratory. It also includes oligochaetes that were taken from the Great Lakes and measured the concentrations in situ. That's pretty good. And so there's a really good relationship between 24-hour 10x and the concentration in the animals. So in theory, I could use this as a predictive tool, right? If I measured the concentration in 10x, and that's really easy to do, it's a 24-hour experiment, I take the 10x off, I extract it, I don't have any cleanup because it's clean, very clean, put it on a GC, and I get a value. The value comes out here, I can go up to my line, come across here, and I can predict what the concentration in the animal is and know that with a fair amount of certainty. That's pretty cool. This project with the USGS is not to look at bioaccumulation. We want to make our lives harder. We want to look at toxicity. Well, toxicity and bioaccumulation sometimes are very similar, sometimes are not. And so we weren't sure when we started working with pyrethroids if this relationship would hold true. So we ran a 24-hour 10x bifenthrin experiment and ran against probates, which just it's a measure of the amount of mortality. And we looked at 3 different animals, Hyalella, Acronymus, and Hexagenia, which is a burrowing mayfly. And you can see the preliminary data was pretty good. It's not as tight as the bioaccumulation, but there was a regression that fit the data fairly well. And so decided to take this further. We wanted to see if we challenged this with a number of different species and a lot of sediments, 50 sediments from the Northeast, from urban areas, can we get a relationship between the 10x 24-hour measurement and toxicity in different species? So we looked at chemically analyzing the sediments, and we ran 24-hour 10x. We ran toxicity bioassays, and we split the toxicity bioassays, so I don't want to bias it. So we ran the 10-day Hyalella test. The Columbia lab duplicates that and runs 10-day tests. They also run a 28-day test, which is a chronic experiment. They run chronic experiments with Chronomus dilutus, which is a midge larvae, and they also do bioassays with the Lampropsilus. So we have a lot of different species that are residing in different parts of the water column, different dietary routes. We're seeing if this works. We are verifying, we actually have already verified the targeted TIEs to determine if the sediments were toxic due to pyrethroids. And we check for and we're going to do this summer, upcoming summer, check for the presence of pyrethroid-resistant Hyalella on the East Coast. We know it's prevalent in California. Is it in the East Coast? I'm not going to spoil a lot of the news, but we are finding pyrethroids. We are finding responses for Hyalella. The USGS has not gotten us their data yet for those. As soon as we get that, then I'll be able to talk about that some more. Do I have just a couple more minutes? So I want to talk a little bit about the impacts of our work. It's always nice when you finish a research project or research projects and you see something happen. Hopefully, I consider this to be favorable in terms of the work. So we have permissible application practices of pyrethroids by professional applicators are being modified, especially in California. that is basically what I mean by that is they're no longer allowed to spray broad areas of impervious surfaces, which they did before this work. In the distance up the house foundation and out from the house, they can only spray 3 feet in both directions before they can spray anywhere. Again, if it's on an impervious surface, it's going off into the drain water. Most pyrethroids are now being re-registered for nationwide, and that process started a couple years ago. They typically have to be registered every 5 to 7 years. This re-registration was prior to their normal timing. Most of the data being used by the USPA for this review was from our data. And in California, our data has led to pyrethroids being placed in re-registration, a process by which, again, the state registrants have to get more data to explain the unrecognized risk. I didn't get to talk to you about the messiest and probably the worst sediments I've ever worked with or water samples, and that was we were asked to do a series of studies with sewage treatment plants. Sewage treatment plants in California were failing their NPDES permits, and they couldn't figure out why. And they don't use Hyalella, they use Daphnia. They were failing the Daphnia component because they had pyrethroids in their effluent. And so we had to, and again, not me, Don Weston went out there and stood there and collected samples in the influent of a sewage treatment plant that handles multiple millions of people. That's not very nice stuff to work with. But as an analytical chemist, it was horrible. Because you talk about matrix effects, it was out of this mind. What was really cool, and again, I'm not showing you the slides, the amount going into the pyrethroids going into the plant was always very consistent. And it was high. As it went to the plant, it would lose about 80%, but it was still at 80% was enough, 80 to 90% was enough to actually have them fail their permit. And so the agency or groups out there, stormwater agencies, have to have sediment toxicity testing as part of their permitting. And the pyrethroid monitoring is now being added to Sacramento's sewage treatment plant for that purpose. About a dozen creeks in California have been added to the 303D list due to pyrethroid impairment. And the state has recently added a potential TMDL for pyrethroids. And so that's pretty big news because there are no other TMDLs for pyrethroids in the United States. So bottom line is pyrethroids are very prevalent in the environment. They do cause problems to non-target species. And I've given you a variety of different experiments and studies where we've shown the effects can range from lethality to adaptation to other effects. So I'll take some questions at this time.
So thank you very much. Very interesting talk. Do we have some questions here in the audience?
Going to the lawn applications, do most of the companies that offer lawn treatment, which most people think of as fertilizer, do they automatically include a herbicide and an insecticide as a preventative, whether the people ask for it or not? Do you have to affirmatively say you do not want an insecticide?
Yeah, I always called it the value pack. Right, so they always throw the insecticide in there because at little cost to you, you get that added benefit. But as I mentioned, the half-lives of a lot of these pyrethroids, and I pick out bifenthrin because that's the one we studied the most, and it's the most problematic. If you have a half-life of a year, and you're applying it 4 times a year, you have too much bifenthrin in your system.
Then do those hurt or kill off the ants and the millipedes and the springtails and the other soil insects in the yard commonly? I assume most of these insects are not resistant.
They're not resistant, and you would affect other non-target terrestrial species too. We just have not looked at those. We've concentrated on the aquatic systems.
Very interesting talk. You know, a lot of research you did. I have two questions. First question, do you know how widely, you know, pyrethroid used in the Illinois, in the urban and in the agriculture? Because you're most talking about California, you know, the case, you know, because their agriculture system is totally different here. Also, you know, the cost of my second question is because if we do some survey in the Illinois watershed, said, you know, if you, we want to collect some sediments from the Illinois watershed, do you think we can we detect, you know, this kind of pesticide in the sediment?
So the first question, let's go. Can you rephrase the first one?
Well, I think he was just wondering, but I thought you had showed some. Is pyrethroids used a lot
in Illinois?
And have you found them in the waterways?
So again, Yuping Ding, one of my former PhD students, looked at urban and ag sites, and what we try to do is target sites that were similar to what we saw in California. Obviously, we have corn here, and they have other crops out there. And the verdict was that the concentrations and the signatures for both urban and ag were very similar to California. And so, however, we do not have the reason why California is so nice, their reporting of data is different than any other state. They keep very good records of homeowner use. They can take very good records for amount of pounds per county, and it's far beyond Illinois' recording of use. And so it would be much more challenging to look at usages in the state. So we have found compounds. I would bet if you would take sediments from urban locations, you would find bifenthrin in particular. Obviously, locations that are highly maintained, so subdivisions that have manicured lots, there's not a lot of pest, obviously in their yards, are going to be more targeted towards using those compounds. But we did look at commercial applicators and people that put pesticides, pyrethroids at bases of houses for termite control, and it's unlikely that they're contributing to the bifenthrin problem in urban sites. From our calculations, it appears to be mostly homeowner-based. And so I wish more states would allow public records of usage, and that would allow for this type of comparison in states like Illinois.
Are there other questions here?
So you mentioned that you did LC50s on 10-day durations and 4-day durations.
Right.
And what I'm wondering is, you did a lot of research, it's very thorough, but in terms of timing, how long do those durations tend to actually exist in streams? Is it just like come in with stormwater and wash out hours later, or is that actually persistent, those durations?
So you're asking how long, what's the half-life of pyrethroids in sediments in the stream?
Right, in terms of exposure and duration.
A year for bifenthrin.
But at the concentrations?
The concentrations, so the interesting component of this, I should thumb to back to my slides, but I'll just try to explain it. If you're coming off of a yard, let's say, it's coming off probably with suspended solids. It doesn't like to move in the freely dissolved phase. So if it's coming off in suspended solids into the aquatic system, it's just going to be incorporated into that sediment. You will get spikes in the water during times, high rain events right after application. That's true for any pesticide. Pyrethroids are included in that. But if you have a pyrethroid that can go out that has a half-life of a year, if it's coming off, you're thinking of 1 yard. Let's talk about a subdivision of 1,000 houses. They're all applying bifenthrin. Those are all going into the system. You will get a pulse that will get down into the sediment, but we collect pyrethroid concentration, or we measure pyrethroid concentrations year-round in California. It's not right after a rain event that we get the elevated concentrations in the sediment. So think of the sediment as a repository for hydrophobic compounds, and pyrethroids are just one of those. And so you're going to find them for extended periods of time. And so I think that the exposure is not a short-term thing. Like chlorpyrifos is much more water-soluble. It gets in the system. It'll be bound to particulates a little bit, but it's eliminated the system fairly quickly, right? And so I think you have a longer half-life for bifenthrin, especially if it gets down inside of the photolytic zone within a sediment or within an aquatic system. Does that address your question?
Any other questions here?
Mike, so I'm interested in the accumulation versus adaptation issue, and my memory might be kind of fuzzy on it, but it seemed like that was rather controversial for a while there, and I'm wondering what's at stake between that distinction. Is it an academic question, or is there
more of a regulatory issue that's at stake there.
I think you have to talk to regulatory people to get an answer to that. I don't know. As an academician, I find it incredibly interesting. I do have a student right now that's actually examining the acclimation component and actually breaking down the pathways, P450 versus phase two versus the cholinesterase pathways for breakdown, and trying to figure out what are the functional pathways for breakdown, and how long does this induction, it appears after one generation from our previous or from our preliminary work that it's gone. And so, but she's testing a lot of those hypotheses. In terms of regulatory concerns, I don't know. I don't think we're to the point where regulatory people are even thinking about that yet, which is unfortunate.
And then one other quick question. So if I heard you right, I thought you were saying that a lot of pyrethroid uptake is through the water column, but Hyalella is, you know, they tried more, and so I'm wondering, have you quantified to what extent they're actually ingesting pyrethroids, and if that has a toxic effect as well in terms of contributing to bioaccumulation?
Yeah, we've not looked at the relative contributions of a dietary uptake, which could occur, and a water-only exposure. Especially, for example, in terms of these toxicity experiments, it's much easier to run in a water-only exposure just to keep track of the individuals. If you try to pick high or low out of a sediment, which you've done, it can be a challenge. So a lot of our stuff has been in a water-only phase. All it's going to do is increase the overall residues you're going to see. And so I think we're probably being very conservative by using a water-only exposure.
Okay, well, thank you very much again.
Yeah.
Dr. Lydy?
Thank you, guys.
And we look forward to our next seminar will be March 16th, where we'll have Sarah Zack here from Illinois Indiana Sea Grant to discuss microplastics in the environment. Thank you.